Alright, it's time for Muertos gang member jank. Well, it's not exactly jank. I'm just borrowing a powerful Leela Patel shell that involves lots of ice denial and de-resing, my emergency shutdown and parasites, as you see in my opening hand, and combining it with Muertos gang member, which should hopefully give me a strong opening. So I'm able to pressure the runners, the corpse eyes from very early on. My opponent mulligans his opening hand, and the first thing he does is use Jackson and install a piece of ice. So this pretty much says that he is flooded and stuff. So the first thing I'm gonna do is to deny his Jackson so that I can pick him off with Sneak Door later. But he doesn't sack Jackson. I thought he would. I thought he would discard an agenda in hand. Instead, he forces me to trash it for 4 credits, which is pretty painful. So I get myself set up with Earthrise Hotel. My opponent then installs a remote and proceeds to money up a bit, which gives me an open R&D to work with, which I'm going to exploit here. If there's an agenda, I'm going to siphon him straight away. It is an agenda, I can't steal it. Jeez. Oh man. That would have totally changed the game. I would have siphoned him down and I'll be very much in the lead. But no, that's not the case. Instead, I'm going to run archives and find a CQ and a space camp. A space camp that he doesn't use, and the CQ burns my account siphon. Ouch, okay. I guess that plan's out the window. So now there's not much point. There's less point in playing aggressively, because even if I steal an agenda, I cannot make use of the open HQ to really leverage on my board state. So in the meantime, he does rest the pack campaign that he put out and passes it over to me. I do have an open security testing, which is good. It's turn 4. I've drawn my first Muertos gang member. It's roughly about average time. I find a future perfect on R&D, so that's fantastic. R&D is unguarded. I can easily steal it if he doesn't defend it by spending credit after credit. So I'm just going to bid 0 every time, and eventually, here you see, he gives up the future perfect. So that worked out pretty well in my favor. However, notice the Muertos gang member sitting in my hand. It's pretty dead. Think about it. I can't really use it until I force the corp to res a piece of ice and trash the pack campaign. Otherwise, when I install Muertos, they'll simply de-res that pack campaign. They'll lose 2 credits. No big deal. So I need to be able to keep up with the corp in terms of trashing the assets and upgrades. But am I really going to spend 6 credits to trash pack campaign? Remember, I'm playing against Industrial Genomics. At that point, he had 2 face downs in his heat in his archives. So you could say that's a bad matchup for me because it costs so much to deny his assets, but in this particular scenario, his board state was only going to continue growing out of control as he installs more and more assets, as you'll see later on. So the Muertos gang members essentially became 3 dead cards in my hand. I mean, I could install them, but it'll just mostly be a waste of a click because the amount of tempo that he will lose is so negligible. I'll be much better off doing more aggressive plays like running his R&D as you saw. It is an efficient card, don't get me wrong. You only need to consider the click to use it because it acts as a delayed draw if you do decide to sack it later on. And usually it'll just stay on the board for most of the game. I played against Leela Patel running Muertos gang member herself, and yes, when you do not have any means of tagging the runner or shooting down the connections, it does get pretty painful when you have only ice rest on the board and they just keep playing more and more Muertos gang members. But for the most part, Muertos gang member is just not good enough. If you don't see it on your first 2 turns, its value decreases very rapidly turn after turn, and in the late game, it's practically useless. So unfortunately, I have to rely on your typical strong criminal tricks for the rest of the game in order to have a fighting chance. Let's watch how this unfolds. So most of the early to mid game involved both me and the corp setting out our board states. I was frantically denying whatever big money assets he had, but kept the pack campaign open for the security testing. In the meantime, he finally found his ice, so I'm not going to run into them anytime soon. I could, I'm a fairy. So it's more or less safe to face check, but I much rather set up my board state because I'm so poor. Most importantly, I'm finding that Desperado that I'm so sorely lacking, it will make my security testings that much better. In the meantime, he does get more assets off, and at this point, his archives is loaded with face downs, so there's no question. I'm not going to contest most of these anymore. He does get a scoring remote set up, and I finally find my breakers, and I get a second security testing going. So at this point, there's a very cool trick that you can do against IG playing Sundew. You can't trash Sundews because they're too expensive, but what you can do is, if you're running security testing, first click run one of the Sundews. So you're getting your security testing money, and at the same time, you're denying the 2 credits from one of the Sundews, which is pretty huge. Do not ever underestimate how powerful Sundew is. It's basically a permanent Eve campaign that costs much less to res. It is that powerful. So at this point, I finally cave in and ran his archives. I know it's loaded with lots of bad stuff. I'm more worried about that than the crit. The crit is easy to break because I've been accumulating sucker tokens. The problem is his archives was basically loaded with 2 shots, 3 shikus, and 3 space camps. 8 trap cards. Ouchie, ouchie, ouch. So he spent 1 space camp to advance one of his remotes, his scoring remote, and 2 of the space camps advancing the ice wall on R&D, which is pretty annoying. It means that it now costs 2 credits to break through ice wall instead of 1. And this allows him to score the NAPD in the remote with less clicks. Which is pretty nice because I would bounce something. But here I forgot that I was Leader Patel, I forgot to bounce a card, so whatever. The game goes on. I lost a lot of tempo from face checking archives, but I had to do that because I needed to basically get rid of all of his face down trashy stuff. So here I do the Sundew trick again, security testing on Sundew, first click run. Here on my second click, I've drawn Masnori, so I get a free card. Here, I exploit the fact that he's pretty weak right now, right after scoring an agenda. He's not in the state to contest my remote run, and this is where criminals shine. They can really abuse the fact that the corp is in a poor board state. I force him to rest Ice Wall and Lotus Field, which I can easily break, and he's forced down to 2 credits, which means Caprice cannot defend herself. Which is pretty good. I think he may have made a mistake. He should have rest the Caprice and the Ice Wall. I don't know if that's the right call or not, but in any case, he shouldn't have rushed agenda the NAPD. The biggest mistake was that he couldn't defend his scoring remote after scoring the NAPD. And the very fact that I ran archives on the turn that he was about to score the NAPD was huge because it meant that I could trash Caprice easily. Alright, so because he didn't see that coming, now he cannot chain his agendas on the remote, and that's pretty huge. Meanwhile, I'm also going to take advantage during the next turn of the fact that he has no face down cards in archives. So, I'm going to security test as normal, but instead of continuing to draw cards and build my board state, I'm going to spend my last 2 clicks denying his Sundews. Never underestimate how powerful Sundews can be. You can let the pet campaigns run because it's not the end of the world, but the Sundews must be trashed. So there we go. Now he has 3 pet campaigns. I could consider trashing some of them later on, because if you look at my economy, it's pretty stable. In fact, with 2 security testings, I'm doing pretty well. 6 credits for 2 clicks every turn if I want. But now I feel like I need to start rushing out agendas. I'm on 2 agenda points, same tied with him because of the Shi Q. It's time to start locking down R&D. So that's exactly what I'm going to do. But first, I'm going to force him to res some HQ ice. Also try to get a feeling of what's on his HQ. First it's a pup, followed by a lotus field. Alright, that's pretty taxing. Let's see what I can get out of this run. He should be agenda flooded. He is, I find, a utopia fragment, bouncing the R&D ice. And this is the perfect time to go on R&D. Breaking the ice wall for 1 credit and a sucker token, which both regenerate themselves with Desperado and sucker. There's a future perfect, he's on 1 credit, I have 1 more click left, so that's game. I can run twice, and he cannot defend his future perfect, I win the game. So this is why money is so very important when competing against IG. Well, I made this video mostly to showcase how badly Muertos gang member performs when you don't draw him early. And I think it's not a very good card. It's not something, even in a denial deck, it is not the most useful card in the world. I suppose it's a consequence of the fact that the meta has shifted to one where it's more asset dominated. As such, most competitive decks have some form of horizontal play, be it nerf, harp, RP, or HP glacier. And as such, it's pretty hard to get a good Muertos gang member off past turn two. In fact, as you see on my screen, the only good matchup is Waylon, and even then, it has to be Blue Sun. It's pretty good against Blue Sun because you can deny early oversight AIs, which is something that Criminal traditionally is horrible at doing. But beyond that, it's a pretty dead card in most other matchups. Well, that's all I have. I would like to hear from your experiences if you have experimented with this card. Thanks for watching and happy netrunning. Goodbye.